We're going to continue our discussion of skeletal muscle with the muscles of the neck, as well as a broad overview of the intrinsic or deep back muscles. And we won't go into a tremendous amount of detail there. We'll talk more about the clinical considerations associated with the muscles of the back. We're going to begin our discussion of the neck with your sternocleidomastoid muscle. This is one of the most dominant muscles of the neck. It's something that you can actually see in an individual, particularly if they're tensing right here. It's a rope-like muscle of the anterior neck, the sternocleidomastoid muscle. A lot of times we abbreviate this as SCM because it's such a long name, but the name really indicates exactly where they're attaching. So you're going to have the sterno portion, meaning that it has an attachment to the sternum. Anytime you have clido, that indicates clavicle. So you have the origins on the sternum and the clavicle, and then its insertion is going to be on the mastoid process. Remember the mastoid process that you can feel right underneath your ear of the temporal bone. And you actually have a continuation of it all the way towards the occipital bone at the nuchal line. So let's everybody palpate that, tense up your neck, and you can feel your sternocleidomastoid muscle there. It's a really good example of a rope-like muscle. And we'll find a few of these throughout the body. Now, this is one of the muscles innervated by your accessory nerve or cranial nerve 11. The other one is going to be on the back. We'll talk about that in just a moment. And as you would think, as it being an anterior neck muscle, it's going to play a big role in terms of the joints associated with your vertebral column or your cervical vertebral column. So if both SCM muscles are contracting, so feel them right here. If they're both contracting, you can really flex, okay, or bend your cervical vertebrae. All right, so that's important in terms of flexion there. Whereas if only one SCM, or sternocleidomastoid muscle, is contracting, you can laterally flex, okay, so to the side, and then look up, and you can feel the entirety of your SCM muscle. So that's when only one of your SCM muscles are contracting. Now, one thing I want you to note, if you're looking at this visual here, you can see these dotted lines in terms of a triangle. A lot of times, clinicians are going to divide areas up, particularly complex areas like the neck, into what we refer to as triangles or separate divisions. In this specific case, the SCM is a big component of your anterior cervical triangle. So you can see midline, SCM, and your mandible right here. This is considered the anterior triangle. You have portions of your thyroid gland, your thymus gland, your hyoid bone is right in this region. You'll have submandibular glands right here. So it's an important landmark, not only in terms of being able to see it for clinicians, but also to divide the neck. All right, let's continue. Now let's go to the back. So another superficial muscle, very important in terms of scapular movement, is your trapezius muscle. And it's actually composed of two different muscles. And let's kind of divide them up right here. And as its name would suggest, it's kind of triangular, trapezoidish shape. It is going to be superficial and superior. And it's going to have expansive bony attachments. So remember the external occipital protuberance that you can feel, that bump on the back of your head. That's going to be one of its more superior attachments. And then it's going to attach all the way down on these spinous processes on your back. So from about C6, C7, all the way down to about L5, because it's going to be part of this thoracolumbar aponeurosis. Then, as you would indicate, it's going to have attachments to the clavicle, but very importantly, it has attachments to the scapula, so that acromion process, or your tip of the shoulder, as well as the spine of the scapula. Like the SCM, or sternocleidomastoid, it is going to be innervated by the accessory nerve. So the accessory nerve has two main functions, and it's these two muscles, these two superficial muscles. And since we have attachments on the scapula and it's such an expansive muscle, most of the actions associated with the scapula, the trapezius is going to play some type of role. So if you think about elevating your shoulders or your scapula, retracting or kind of putting it back into place, rotating your scapula superiorly, trapezius is going to play a role depending on which particular fibers are contracting. Okay. We're not going to go into a great amount of detail, but there are some deeper muscles within the neck, so particularly in the anterior neck. So in these visuals here, I want to note that the sternocleidomastoid muscle has been reflected in order for us to be able to see these. And you're going to have two main types of muscles here. You have your suprahyoid, and as the name would indicate, suprahyoid means above the hyoid bone, so these muscles in this region. And then you have your infra-hyoid muscles, and you can see these better in this visual, below the hyoid bone. All right, and both of these types have four separate muscles. We're not going to worry about memorizing these names, but I want you to understand kind of the main function of these. So suprahyoid muscles, right under here, right underneath your mandible, they're going to constitute the floor of the mouth. So we just talked recently about the muscles of the tongue. You have a very large complex there, but right underneath those muscles of the tongue that are forming the floor of the mouth are these suprahyoid muscles. Underneath the hyoid, the infrahyoid muscles, a lot of times we refer to these as strap muscles because they do look like straps. You have infrahyoid. These play a big role in terms of depressing the hyoid, but really importantly in terms of depressing your larynx. So when swallowing and speaking, it's going to allow some type of movement of the larynx and can play a big role in terms of respiration and voice production. All right, one more muscle in terms of the anterior neck that I want you to understand. This will come back again when you're talking about the vascular component of anatomy, and the neuro component is the anterior scalene. And you actually have three scalenes. This is the most significant one. And you can see it right here in this visual. It's going to have an attachment to the vertebral column all the way down to the first rib. All right, so deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle, obviously. And the reason we want to talk about this now is it's an important anatomical landmark. It really helps divide the large artery and plexus in this region. So the large artery, which we can see in this visual, is your subclavian artery. And you will talk quite a bit about this when you get to the vascular component. And you can see that it's dividing the subclavian artery into three different parts. Now, deep to the subclavian artery, and you can see a little bit of that here, is a very important neuro component referred to as the brachial plexus. And the brachial plexus provides all the afferent and efferent innervation for the entirety of the upper limb. Okay? So if you have an enlargement or an inflammation of the anterior scalene, it can affect these neurovascular components in this region. All right, now let's talk about muscles of the back as well as the neck that are going to move the vertebral column. And these we refer to more as your deep back muscles. So the trapezius that we just discussed is considered a superficial back muscle. The deep back muscles play a big role in terms of allowing for you to stand upright. You're always going to have a little bit of a tonic contraction to allow for you to sit upright, stand upright. Also, it's very important in terms of extension, all right? So the main complex of muscles that we want to discuss are your erector spinae muscles, which are actually composed of three types. And I always remember these as I love spaghetti, okay? I love spaghetti. You have your iliocostalis. These are going to be the lateral. You have your lumbo right here, which is going to be the medial, or your longissimus. You have that either way. You hear it both ways. And then your spinalis. And of course, with the spinalis, you know that has to do with the spinal column, so that's got to be a more medial muscle. So these are very important in terms of extension. They also play a role in terms of lateral flexion. And you can feel those contract as you do that. And these muscles come up quite a bit because they're very important in terms of clinical importance. These are commonly strained. So if you think of when individuals tell you to lift with your legs, not with your back, we're really considering these muscles right here because that these muscles can become strained, become inflamed, and any time that you have inflammation of these muscles in this region, this can be a common cause of back pain. So these are the main muscles that we wanted to discuss today in terms of the neck and the back. We're going to continue our discussion in terms of a more anterior or thorax portions of the skeletal muscle.